umbrella.
What is good, my people? We are live back again with another episode of The Forecast. Now, I definitely need to talk to my people because, yeah, shit is fucking real, but it's always been real. The point is, we need to be on the same fucking page so we can get to where we gotta go, and we gotta know what's going on around us. Now, you know, a couple of months ago, and it's always been happening, but Jeff Sessions, you know, the pick by Trump, he updates the war on drugs, you know, and reinforces it and all of that. So, you know, I want to let him speak for himself so you can hear what he plans to do about the war on drugs.
Today, I am announcing that I sent a memo to each of our United States attorneys last night establishing a charging and sentencing policy for this Department of Justice. Our responsibility is to fulfill our role in a way that accords with law, advances public safety, and promotes respect for and consistency in our legal system. I have empowered our prosecutors to charge and pursue the most serious offense, as I believe the law requires, most serious, readily provable offense. It means that we're going to meet our responsibility to enforce the law with judgment and fairness. It is simply the right and moral thing to do. We are seeing an increase in violent crime in our cities, particularly in Baltimore, Chicago, Memphis, and Milwaukee, St. Louis, and many others. The murder rate has surged 10% nationwide, the largest increase in murder since 1968. And we know that drugs and crime go hand in hand. They just do. The facts prove that so. If you want to collect a drug debt, you can't file a lawsuit in court. You collect it with the barrel of a gun. In 2015, more than 52,000 Americans died from a drug overdose. That's a stunning number. According to a report by the New England Journal of Medicine, the price of heroin is down, its purity is up, and its availability is up. We intend to reverse this trend. We are returning to the enforcement of the laws as passed by Congress, plain and simple. If you are a drug trafficker, we will not look the other way, and I trust our prosecutors in the field to make good judgments. They deserve to be unhandcuffed and not micromanaged from Washington.
All right, so that's Attorney General Jeff Sessions, Trump's pick. And I know what you're thinking, right? Because I was one of those people who said I'm not voting for Hillary Clinton or Donald Trump. And I looked at the other people, but you know what? Fuck the goddamn vote for president. That's what I said. And now everybody's saying, well, look, you should have voted for Hillary Clinton. Because it's not like Hillary Clinton would update the war on drug policy. No, wait, she did.
Not just gangs of kids anymore. They are often the kinds of kids that are called super predators. No conscience, no empathy. We can talk about why they ended up that way, but first we have to bring them to heal.
So you can miss me with all of that bullshit. Now, I want you to notice all of the things he's saying, right? And see who the people it affects. Because all the statistics he was naming, this is epidemics going on in the white community. All right, let's be real. It's white people who's ODing on goddamn heroin out here. And the irony is they don't even realize they put little white kids on Ritalin and all these kind of prescription drugs when they're in school. They put black kids on the same thing and they just suspend their ass. And these little white kids grow up to be teenagers and then adults who become addicted to taking pills. And when they run out of that supply or they get hurt or something and they start taking pills. And let's be real, white people have always been doing drugs. So he's talking about the epidemic going on in the white community. Because right now, I don't really see an epidemic of drugs going on in the black community. That's not our problem. We got past the goddamn crack era, right? It took this till this generation to see the goddamn long-term effects of the crack epidemic. Well, as far as what crack does to you, and to weed ourselves off of it. It ain't no epidemic going on in the black community. So are you saying that you're targeting these drug laws to white people who deal with meth, who deal with heroin? You know what I'm saying? Are you talking about targeting Walter White out this motherfucker? Cooking motherfucking meth in the desert somewhere? No, you're talking about black people with marijuana. Non-violent drug offenders. Now, one part of Obama's legacy that I will say, you know what? This is something that he did for black people. Not exclusively for black people. But him giving all them pardons and him trying to reduce the sentencing gap as much as possible. We know who that was for. He took the crack to cocaine difference and took it from 100 to 1 to 18 to 1. All right, he didn't make it square, but he did bring it down. And they immediately reversed that shit. And so just in a local story that came out a couple of weeks ago and where I live, right, and it talks about the numbers behind racial disparities in marijuana arrests across Virginia. And it says, Hanover County, just north of Richmond, has about 88,000 white residents. And in an average year, 246 whites are arrested for marijuana possession. That represents a rate of 280 white people for every 100,000 residents that is arrested. On the other hand, it's about 9,600 black people also living in Hanover County. And in an average year, 171 blacks are arrested for marijuana possession. That represents a rate of 1,779 black arrests for every 100,000 black residents, compared to 280. There's 88,000 white people living in Hanover. 246 white people are arrested for marijuana. 9,600 black people live in Hanover. 171. It says, statistically, that means Africans or black people are more than six times as likely as whites to be arrested for possessing marijuana in Hanover. Is it because they do it any less? Hell no. Let me be the one to tell you. White people smoke some fire ass weed. They ain't doing the shit less. Just as a black person living in Richmond, Virginia, once you start going outside of the major cities, these are places where you don't want to get caught after dark alone with no protection. You're liable to get hung out there. That's the surrounding areas where I live. I know, I've seen it. Places where one black family lives there. And it says, you know, the analysis looked at records on more than 160,000 arrests by local and state law enforcement agencies from 2010 through 2016. It found that the racial disparity in marijuana arrests has increased over the years. In 2010, the arrest rate for blacks was 2.9 times the arrest rate for whites. In 2016, black people were 3.2 times as likely to be arrested as whites for weed. So here are some of the marijuana arrest rates. In Richmond, 491 black people compared to 345 white people. In places like Arlington, 145 white people and 1,173 black people. In Chesterfield, and people who live in Richmond know about Chesterfield, 1,070 black people arrested compared to 322 white people for marijuana. In Henrico, 450 compared to 123. Norfolk, 447 compared to 86. Look, we all know what this is for. They make terrible schools and they don't invest in them, close them down. They build brand new state-of-the-art prisons. We know that they get paid for prisoners that they have. They have to pay for each cell, whether they got a head in them or not. So their priority is to fill up jail cells. And for those white people who say, well, you know, I'm not racist. I don't see color. I fucking think everybody has the same opportunity or should have the same opportunity. How about this, right? All you have to do is write to your local legislator, you know, show up to council meetings, do something, make noise, and say, I want the war on drugs to stop. I am totally against the stop and frisk policies. I mean, most of them probably won't do it, but if you really want to do that, then do those two things, because those two policies is directly meant to affect us. And even in the story, it mentions how Hanover is in between Richmond and D.C., which a lot of people make that trip. So they probably get a lot of people making the travels down 301 or going up 95. And they probably arrest some shit of people doing that. Now, that's a whole nother issue of just being stopped by the police. It's sort of like in the store, they follow you on the goddamn road, they follow you. You're fucking walking, they follow you. They always following you, saying you look suspicious, and then get out and kill you. And you're the violent one at the end of the day. This is America. And to black people, stop fucking arguing with them. Stop fucking saying that shit to them. They know what the hell is going on. They know what they're doing. They admit that the war on drug policy isn't broken. Now, we can all see it's wasting some shit of taxpayer money. It's arresting some shit of black people. But in their mind, they look at it as killing two birds with one stone. We can make some shit of money by locking out black people. How is it so many more white people in America, yet we are in jail about the same percentage? It's more black people in jail by far. Don't give me that more violent shit, because we can look up body counts and see who's more violent. If black people are inherently violent or if white people are inherently violent, if we want to go down that path, we can definitely check body counts. We as our own people have to start creating our own narratives. Of course, they're going to try to jump in it and change it, because you know why? We are in a war. It is about money. Money as in resources, not paper, dollar bills. And to extort the richest continent in the world, the richest land in the world, which happens to be in Africa, and its damn people who tend to make up trends that spread throughout the whole world, and people love to see us play basketball and love to see us sing on stage and come up with music and do all kind of entertaining shit, and they love to run with that and love to take our styles and make money off of it, by the way, which we don't fucking do. At the end of the day, we all we got. That's why I say we need to become local politicians, the local representatives, so you can be in charge of who's the damn police, so you can be in charge of who's the damn prosecutor, who's the goddamn DA. So, you know, all my brothers, all my sisters out there, be safe. They're just introducing more policies, and I tend to think it's better that Trump got elected, because Hillary would be doing this shit on the goddamn slide. She would do it with a smile on her face. That was really the election. Do you want the smile on your face, or do you just want it flat out, all out front? I want to see what the hell we're doing, we're dealing with. Because maybe this will give us the fucking thing we need to get over that goddamn hump and stop arguing about the surface level shit. That's the thing that's keeping us divided, surface level shit. While these motherfuckers are in line, they are in line. And no, not all white people are racist, but think about it like this. There are enough racist people that racist ass representatives can keep getting elected and keep putting in place racist ass policies. Just keep in mind. Enough people identify under the banner of white that we have no choice but to identify under the banner of black. Fuck all that as a status thing. Your status is what you can fucking say and do. If I tell you I ain't no motherfucking slave and it's just me, you gonna laugh in my face. If I tell you I ain't no slave and I got an army behind me, it's a different story. Don't matter what the hell you call yourself, but you got to get on the same goddamn page. And they're on the same page. So.
The only problem is that if you go back to what Clinton was actually talking about in 1996, she wasn't talking about crimes committed against children. She was talking about crimes committed by children. Children who at that time were called super predators. It's a 20-year-old myth that has been disproven over and over, but a myth that led to some very serious consequences. In the mid-1990s, criminologists issued predictions of a coming wave of super predators. These were, they said, radically impulsive, brutally remorseless elementary school youngsters who pack guns instead of lunches and have absolutely no respect for human life. That was how super predators were defined. In 1995, John DeLulio, a professor at Princeton who coined the term super predator, predicted that the number of juveniles in custody would increase threefold in the coming years, and that by 2010, there would be an estimated 270,000 more young predators on the streets than in 1990. Those predictions would turn out to be completely untrue. Even so, something incredible came from all of it. That myth 20 years ago, it led to nearly every state in the country between 1992 and 1999 expanding laws that removed children from juvenile courts and exposed them instead to adult sentences, including life without parole. But the idea that children, especially young minority children, were becoming super predators was not only untrue, statistically it fell apart. Violent juvenile crime rates had already started to fall in the mid-1990s when this prediction was made. And by the year 2000, the juvenile homicide rate stabilized below the 1985 level. Bill Clinton has already been heavily criticized for policies that led to mass incarceration, but the super predator theories, they had an incredible toll that we still feel today. That's because right now, even as I'm speaking to you, children as young as 10 years old continue to be exposed to adult prosecution in the United States. Today in America, 10,000 children are housed in adult jails and prisons, and nearly 3,000 American children have been sentenced to die in prison. Policies that cannot be laid only at the feet of Bill and Hillary Clinton, but every politician and state leader who voted for draconian laws based on a scary name like super predator.
In 1986, when I was coming of age, Ronald Reagan doubled down on the war on drugs that had been started by Richard Nixon in 1971. Drugs were bad, fried your brain, and drug dealers were monsters, the sole reason neighborhoods and major cities were failing. No one wanted to talk about Reaganomics and the ending of social safety nets, the defunding of schools and the loss of jobs in cities across America. Young men like me who hustled became the sole villain, and drug addicts lacked moral fortitude. In the 1990s, incarceration rates in the U.S. blew up. Today, we imprison more people than any other country in the world. China, Russia, Iran, Cuba. All countries we consider autocratic and repressive. Yeah, more than them. Judges' hands were tied by tough-on-crime laws, and they were forced to hand out mandatory life sentences for simple possession and low-level drug sales. My home state of New York started this with Rockefeller laws. Then the feds made distinctions between people who sold powder cocaine and crack cocaine, even though they were the same drug. Only difference is how you take it. And even though white people used and sold crack more than black people, somehow it was black people who went to prison. The media ignored actual data to this day. Crack is still talked about as a black problem. The NYPD raided our Brooklyn neighborhoods while Manhattan bankers openly used coke with impunity. The war on drugs exploded the U.S. prison population, disproportionately locking away black and Latinos. Our prison population grew more than 900%. When the war on drugs began in 1971, our prison population was 200,000. Today it is over 2 million. Long after the crack era ended, we continued our war on drugs. There were more than 1.5 million drug arrests in 2014. More than 80% were for possession only. Almost half were for marijuana. People are finally talking about treating addiction to harder drugs as a health crisis, but there's no compassionate language about drug dealers. Unless, of course, we're talking about places like Colorado, whose state economy got a huge boost by the above-ground marijuana industry. A few states south in Louisiana, they're still handing out mandatory sentences for people who sell weed. Despite a booming and celebrated $50 billion legal marijuana industry, most states still disproportionately hand out mandatory sentences to black and Latinos with drug cases. If you're entrepreneurial and live in one of the many states that are passing legalized laws, you may still face barriers participating in an above-ground economy. Venture capitalists migrate to these states to open multi-billion dollar operations, but former felons can't open a dispensary. Lots of times those felonies were drug charges, caught by poor people who sold drugs for a living, but are now prohibited from participating in one of the fastest growing economies. Got it? In states like New York, where holding marijuana is no longer grounds for arrest, police issue possession citations in black and Latino neighborhoods at a far higher rate than other neighborhoods. Kids in Crown Heights are constantly stopped and ticketed for trees. Kids at dorms in Columbia, where rates of marijuana use are equal to or worse than those in the hood, are never targeted or ticketed. Rates of drug use are as high as they were when Nixon declared the so-called war in 1971. 45 years later, it's time to rethink our policies and laws. The war on drugs is an epic fail.
When the people that were being arrested turned out to be middle-class white residents of the town, yes, they were surprised.
The media has done a very effective job about portraying the culprits, so to speak, as being black and brown. However, within the state of Connecticut, and it holds true throughout the country, that 83% of the people that die from illegal drugs are not black and brown, they are white. And see, in a town where I live in, 30,000 people, predominantly a white town, is that of 30,000 people, we're averaging one heroin death a month in Glastonbury, Connecticut. Now, most people, and here we go again with that fear and the intellectual dishonesty that fear promotes, is that these people are fearful to come forward because, first of all, they don't want their family ostracized or criticized, and they feel it would give the town a bad name.
I know, as an ex-officer in this town, that we have brought children out of elementary schools who were carrying and selling drugs in elementary schools. We know that drug dealers do not ask for identification. They do not care how old their customers are. They only care about whether or not they have the money to purchase the drugs that they are selling.
People have said, why is it that suddenly, now that white people in suburbs and rural areas are dying from overdose, why is it suddenly this public health emergency when in Baltimore City and in other urban areas, there have been people with addiction dying from overdose for decades? It's true that we have had long-standing discriminatory policies that have fostered racism, that have worsened inequality, and that it is a problem, that it is too late, that we're just now paying attention to this issue now that there are white people in suburbs who are dying. So we have to acknowledge that and say that there is stigma, that If you are wealthy and you have an addiction, somehow you can check yourself into a clinic and get treatment. But if you're poor and you have an addiction, then somehow that's a crime. And it is a moral failing and a choice. So we need to change that narrative and say that addiction is something that affects every single person. There is no one face of addiction. We need to stop tossing people into jail because they have a disease. And criminal justice reform, along with our understanding of what is the nature of the disease of addiction.
All right, and we back on the forecast. Speaking about the war on drugs and the stop and frisk policies and how they disproportionately affect black people, which, I mean, damn, after all these years, I'm still saying the same goddamn thing. But for more insight on how the police see the whole racial dynamic in America today, generally in this society, not all, because nothing is all, but generally.
Following lawsuit, a Hastings police officer is suing the chief and city leaders there. The officer, who recently discovered he's 18% black, is suing over his co-workers' reactions to his newfound ethnicity. 24-Hour News 8's Joe LaFerge is here with this story.
And Brian, this lawsuit could cost the city of Hastings a bundle, but the attorney for the officer says it's not about the money.
It all began when an ancestry research site answered a lingering question Hastings Police Sergeant Cleon Brown had about his lineage.
And when he found out he was 18% African American, he was very proud of it.
But according to Brown's Detroit area attorney, not everyone at Hastings PD shared in his pride. It started in the office one day last fall. Boylan claims Chief Jeff Pratt spotted Brown.
He saw Cleon standing there and said, "Hey, Kunta," as in Kunta Kinte. And Cleon's response, incredulously, was, "I cannot believe you just called me that."
Details in the civil rights violation lawsuit filed by Brown in early April indicate things went downhill for Brown, a 19-year veteran of the force, from there. Claims of fist pumps and whispers of Black Lives Matter from fellow officers as they passed Brown. The most public evidence appeared on the Christmas tree in the lobby of the PD. Decorations including Santa figurines with the names of each officer. Brown Santa was black with 18% written on the beard.
These are law enforcement officers. These are people who are supposed to understand cultural sensitivities.
The lawsuit names the city Chief Jeff Pratt, Deputy Chief Dale Bolter, Sergeant Chris Miller, and City Manager Jeff Mansfield as defendants. Boylan says the defendants created a hostile work environment, that Brown was ostracized and basically frozen out. Boylan believes it's created a dangerous environment.
I don't see that any officer that has been retaliating against him is going to come to Cleon's aid.
So, if proven, what should the price tag be on the alleged misconduct? Boylan says they want to force the city to provide better racial sensitivity training for officers, but she says the lawsuit can't award that, only cash, in this case at least $500,000. Hastings City Manager says they are aware of the lawsuit but can't comment.
All right, so this white-ass man is filing a civil rights lawsuit against the police for racial discrimination. So for all of you who do not see color, here you have a white man who gets a DNA test, and I think we all should get DNA tests. It might be interesting what we find. But he found out he's 18% black or African. And so the police start ridiculing him. Probably would never let him live it down, to the point where he had to quit and is now suing his ass. Now, I hate to say that this is probably the typical reaction from white people, but it has been pretty typical throughout the years. Now, just imagine what it's really like when you're out here walking down the streets, when you're driving in your car. When the police pull up behind you, it's almost like a motherfucker pulling up on you who gonna do a drive-by on you. You just know when you're gonna get pulled. And people talk about sensitivity training and bias training. That's a bunch of bullshit. Some of them join the police with the intent of going out to kill black people, believe it or not, or kill non-whites. Members of the KKK intentionally go out and join the police force just to achieve that goal. But, you know, just your average person, because police are human beings. I don't know if we are aware of that or not, but they are average human beings. And just as a regular person, black people too, included. When you see 2, 3, 4 black people walking down the streets, they could have on white t-shirts. God forbid they have dreads or something. What is the first thing that crosses your mind? Just close your eyes and imagine walking down the streets. It could be 12 noon, sun out, nice day, streets crowded. A couple of black kids walk past you. You start gripping your purse a little tighter. You start, just catch the first thought that comes to your mind. Defend myself or anything. Now picture 3, 4 white kids coming down the damn street. What's the first thing that pops in your head? You don't even think about it. Now, do you think the police don't got the same kind of thought process that we're all ingrained with? It's damn near taught to us. Right? They try to force down your throat about, oh, well, black people are so fucking violent. Do we need to check body counts? So, of course, the first thing to your mind is, it's probably going to be a violent situation. So now you have these same people ordered to go out there and harass some shit of fucking people who happen to be black, Hispanic people, non-white Hispanic people. Because Hispanic is not a race. They use the minority term, but Hispanic is not a race. Anytime that white woman is included with minority, I mean, come on, how serious can we take it? You mean the majority of the population and the majority of the voter block is a minority class? The hell does minority mean? No, these laws are to target our people. They create laws where if you resist arrest, it's a hate crime. They already kill your ass anyway and say, I feared for my life and start crying and shit like that. But everywhere you go, you get the same fucking results. Florida, Texas, anywhere they did a damn investigation, they found racism in the police department. Not any breaking news to black people. We've only been saying that shit for 100 years. That's why we got to stop saying this shit to them and talk within our own community and come up with ways to get out of this shit. But at the end of the day, no matter what we come up with, if we can't defend ourselves and protect it and put respect behind our own goddamn names, then it don't mean shit. Asking them to pass a law don't mean shit. Right? They try to hang you with fucking words and then they violate their own goddamn words. They end up becoming hypocrites from their own words because they can't even do it. But they still hold it against you and it's still different when you do it. Policing, jailing has always been a money business. At first, they hire people to go catch runaway slaves. Now they hire people to keep the unruly niggas in line. But, you know, this cop here finally gets a taste and decides, well, damn, this is too much to fucking take. And his was just fucking jokes. Imagine living this shit for real. Imagine if he was 100% black. He couldn't even take being 18% black for a couple of weeks or a couple of months.
We'd love to have you work in the fields with us. Work in the fields?
That's part of that. That's...
Senator, I'm a house nigga. No, it's a joke. Thank
you. Are you running up?
No, nigga.
Who the fuck are you calling a nigga? Who the fuck are you calling a nigga? Who in the fuck are you calling a nigga?
Don't touch me.
Oh my God!
Bitch,
hey, hey, hey! That's Aaliyah. Enough, Aaliyah! Aaliyah, stop! Aaliyah! Aaliyah! No, Aaliyah!
See him, Juby, bitch!
Don't let her hear you.
Bro, what the fuck?
Fucking nigger!
Oh, hell! Damn it, damn it!
Oh, shit.
Go get it, go get it!
Controversy right now. A teacher used the N-word towards a student. The word is only six letters long, but the impact is far-reaching. And we do want to warn you that some of the language in this story is strong, and it may offend you, it may offend some other people. But since this story is not just about the N-word, it's also about the teacher's intent and definition of the word, we have decided to leave it in the story for you to decide.
And what did he say specifically to you?
Sit down, nigga.
Keyshawn Chambers is a freshman at Valley High School, a Boy Scout, a football player, a member of the ROTC, an honor roll student. He was hanging around his teacher's classroom door in December. The teacher told him to sit down, and the teacher says that Keyshawn used the N-word first.
And I just kind of was stunned a second. Well, then get away from the door, nigga. And I repeated the same insult because that's sort of what I've been trained to do.
The school district says that is not what they trained English teacher Paul Dawson to do.
He tried to say I said it, and I didn't say it, and no one else in the class knows that I said it, because I didn't.
Documents from the school investigation show that several of the students interviewed from Valley did not hear Keyshawn say the N-word first. Dawson says that students use the slang version of the N-word at Valley High School all the time. He says N-I-G-G-E-R is a racial slur, but says that students use N-I-G-G-A as often as they'd say dude or hey man. And Dawson says as much as he does not like the word, he still used the slang version to feel more comfortable with black students.
Why is this word used so frequently, so... I just don't understand it, and I'm trying to understand it. I need help. Yes, I use nigga. I've used it. I admit it. I put the H on it to emphasize it's nigga. That, you know, nigga this, nigga please, nigga. Can you lend a nigga a pencil?
What kind of example are you setting for your students if you use a word that you don't want them to use?
Upon reflection, that's not good.
Dawson was suspended for 10 days without pay from January 9th to January 23rd, and he has to go to diversity training. He says that he's learned from this experience and hopes that others think twice before using the N-word.
I will never say any form of nigga. I'm cured of that.
Excuse me, I see you dropping on that floor. Why
side, start docking when she rocking down that pool. Like, hey yo, she pocket all that dough. Hey yo, she pocket all that dough. Hey, see, I be running game constantly, but honestly, apology ain't hard for me. So, baby girl, don't bother me. Your jealous friends make it hard for me, but hating is a possibly. I'm modestly in love with your mahogany. She lick it, lick it, lick it, lick it like pornography. So ooh wee, who's he? Questions, no suggestions, stupid answers. Even fanning her pajamas make these girls go bananas. Like my swagger, like my grandma, ask my grandma. I've been pimping since my Pampers, baby. I'm crazy, like Goo Goo and Gaga. I'm so cool and so flat. She get wet when it's dry. Why you cry? Wipe your ass. I know you mad because you wish my truth can sound like a laugh. And when I'm beating, I be skeeting like American Pat. My baby got in your ass. Then wipe it off, can I pause straight? Get a applause and I be up in the building with them ghetto children. Got them girls shaking ass. Excuse me, I see you dropping on that floor. Watch how they start docking when she rocking down that pool. Like, hey yo, she pocket all that dough. Hey yo, she pocket all that dough. Excuse me, I see you dropping on that floor. Watch how they start jocking when she rocking down that pool. Like, hey yo, she pocket all that dough. Hey yo, she pocket all that dough.
Excuse me, I see you popping from the back. Drop way shorty move and make the DJ run it back. Like, hey yo. My niggas get it crunk. She shaking from the front and I still see her ass. Baby girl off the chains, I know she making all the cash. I know with me, you can work for every cent.
Get to work.
I know you lying to him, I tell him exactly what I meant. And your boy always starting and you always on the bench. Like it ain't making sense,
nah.
Get the picture, she said I like it from the back. That's how I keep getting thicker.
I see.
I can see how pain fell in love with a stripper. At least hit it twice before I quit it. Damn, she give me righteous 5 cents. Extra hard in my pants. Got
dance.
These niggas lining up just to watch shorty dance. Throwing money on the stage and she pocket every dollar. But if you throw it right, baby girl, I'ma holler like,
excuse me, I see you dropping on that floor. Watch how they start jocking when she rocking down that pool. Like, hey yo, she pocket all that dough. Hey yo, she pocket all that dough. Excuse me, I see you dropping on that floor. Watch how they start jocking when she rocking down that pool. Like, hey yo, she pocket all that dough. Hey yo, she pocket all that dough.
Yeah.
$8 in her thumb and she earned it. Mommy make these other hoes look uncertain.
I don't
twerking
know.
On all fours. I took a long pause. No disrespect, shorty, this what you was born for. And she was feeling that in the show appreciation. My song came on, standing ovation. She had it wiggling, she kept it jiggling. Put it on vibrate, looked like she was shivering. Focus on arithmetic, call her my mail lady. Cause every time I make it rain, mommy still delivering.
Here she come.
Angel eyes in her face looking innocent. Couple tattoos in the body on some sinner shit.
Damn.
But that's the purpose, to make you purchase. Come in this bitch rich, ass leave worthless. Seemingly perfect, but she'll have your ass copping in Beverly Hills. You Eddie Murphy. You excuse, bitch. Know what I'm saying?
That all right, and we back on the forecast. And my brothers, my sisters, be careful out there. You know, they really don't need a law to do anything, but they just make a law just to, I guess, make themselves feel better because they know what the hell they're doing. And they break their own goddamn laws anyway. So, y'all be safe out there. And as always, man, we have got to start standing for something. Or we can keep falling for anything.